रुभ्यो नमः हरि ओम समस्त जन कल्याणे निरतं करुणामयं नमामि चिन्मयं देवं सद्गुरुं ब्रह्मविद्वरं ओम भद्रं कर्णेभिः शृणुयाम देवाः भद्रं पश्येमाक्षभिर्यजत्राः स्थिरैरंगैः सुष्टुवागंस्तनूभिः विषेम देवहितं यदायुः स्वस्ति न इंद्रो वृद्धश्रवाः स्वस्ति न पूषा विश्ववेदाः स्वस्ति नस्ताक्षो अरिष्टनेमिः स्वस्ति नो बृहस्पतिर्ददातु ॐ शांति 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 हरि ओम श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः हरि ओम ऑल ऑफ यू इनवोक योर इष्ट देवता एंड सद्गुरु महाराज टुडे व्हाट वी आर एमिंग एट थ्रू हिज ब्लेसिंग्स एंड गाइडेंस and an intuitive feeling that if you're all properly tuned up, you may have a glimpse of that experience itself today. And therefore, you have to bring the heart in line with the head. Hence, as Kaivalya Upanishad says, Bhaktya Swargurum Pranamya. Prostrate mentally to your Guru, Krishna, your Ishta Devata, and then let us see what we are going to listen. We normally, normal people, average people, go to temple or do pujas, prayers for the welfare of the family, for gaining certain things, money, health, position, children, name, etc. Nothing wrong. Bhagavan himself says nothing wrong in the seventh chapter. Arthati. Absolutely nothing wrong. Don't feel guilty if you are doing this. But there are a few who have completely gone through the height of the blessings the world can give. Prosperity, name, fame, children, however, they found they cannot give them completeness. I have two examples of history. I'm not talking from Purana. About 400 years back, Pattinattar in South was a rich businessman, importing even in those days through ships. Due to an event, he suddenly discovered the futility of money. So he just came out of the house. His secretary followed and said, what do I do with the money? Because in the house, though in those days there was no bank, 9 crore worth 400 years back. That means today's whole India's GDP. 9 crore worth money, jewels were there. He said to the manager who asked him, when I don't need them, why should I assume somebody needs and give advice? Throw them on the road. And it was thrown on the road. This Pattinattar, while on his pilgrimage, in another interesting incident which I don't want to go, because now I my business is Mandukya, and at the quickest time I have to enter there. There was another incident where Raja Bhartruhari, who is a famous author of Subhashitas, Vairagya Satakam, Sringara Satakam, etc., etc., he became his disciple. So some goes to the temple and to God for artharthi, some to seek God, throw them all out. To seek God, throw them all out. Another historical figure, all of you know, is Siddhartha, who became Gautama Buddha. Through the kingdom of wife, just born child, everything, in search of God, eternal, peaceful. This state of mind is well described in Mundaka Upanishad. Pariksha lokan karma chitan nirveda maya, having analyzed and seeing what this world can give, born out of actions. This world is nothing but activity. Anything that you can gain here or through actions. What this world can give, nirveda maya, he became indifferent. Why? Because he has understood, nahi akrutaha krutena, akrutaha, that which is not an effect of any cause, that which is not produced, that which is not reformed, that which is not obtained, akrutaha, not a product, effect of any cause or action, krutena, through actions, how do you get that fullness? So he goes to his teacher to gain this knowledge. So that is the adhikari fit for this knowledge. Adhikari means one who has the qualifications. Oh, I don't have that. What do? You can develop all the qualities. All seeds are in us. All seeds are in us. Rama seed is in us. Ravana seed is in us. Whatever you water, that will grow. So, develop these qualities of Viveka, trying to analyze, Vairagya, detachment from the false, and self-control. Contemplate, you shall discover. So this is the adhikari who goes to a teacher, restless, agitated. He says, Durvara Samsara Davagrita, I'm burnt all sides from this fire which cannot be controlled. Duduyamanam Durdushta Vatai. Added to that, the fire is becoming aggressive due to the winds of desires. And approaches the teacher. The teacher sees the urgency of the student. He doesn't give a lecture like what I am doing. Says immediately, Mabhaista Vidvan Tavanastya Paya. Vidvan, don't worry. You have nothing to fear. You have no danger. You have nothing to fear. You have no danger. As Sri Gurudev says, you are not lost in a dream. You are dreaming, you are lost. You are dreaming, you are lost. So he says, there is no danger for you. It's all an imagination. Say it calmly, beautifully, we will discuss. Same thing here in Mandukya Upanishad. Rushes to the teacher. The teacher, Sri Gurudev portrays the whole scenario. Uttarkashi comes before our eyes. Tapovan Maharaj and Gurudev. That's the way Gurudev describes the scene. So the student goes to the teacher and the teacher sees the urgency of the student and says, yeah, you want that? You want a solution? You want something beyond the chain? You want something beyond this finite nature? You want something beyond the sorrows? You want something beyond fears? You want something behind all inadequacies? Yes, there is. It is womb. The fellow gets a shock. I am asking some practical solution to tell me how to get out of this. He simply says womb, and that is the solution. What do I get out of that? Merely saying womb. We will see the beauty of this as we go. But that is an answer. That's the right answer. It's an apt answer. Nothing beyond it. What is this womb? Is the name of what you are seeking. The fullness. The ananda. The knowledge. Sat Chit Ananda. This is what you are seeking. Freedom from all limitations. This is womb. The name of that is womb. When you say a name, automatically the entire picture comes before you. You say pot. Try to tell pot without pot picture coming before you. When you say any name, its form comes before you. That's there is a connection between name and form. Similarly, when womb is said, entire truth comes before you. What is this truth? What do you want it? Moksha, no, I am not interested. These are all brainwashes, words, moksha and all that. I am agitated. My thirst for things is insatiable. I have fears. I am restless. I want a solution for that. Says that is womb. What womb conveys? Before that, let us simply see, because I am not going in the traditional way of teaching, because I myself, like all of you, is in a hurry. We'll find the answer. Get vaccinated and then go into the details of corona. There is no time now to inquire where from it started, how it started. The urgency is for a vaccine. So therefore, simply when he says, oh, that is the answer for all your inadequacies, fears, agitations, etc. How? Let us take an example to come at this truth. What is a ocean? Millions of gallons of water fallen on Himalayas, like that, high plateaus, rushing and meeting at a place, become the ocean. Follow step by step, please, what I'm saying. Every bit is important. If you now miss when I try to connect at the last, you may not be able to catch it. Millions and trillions of gallons of water in streams and rivers form the ocean. Now, what is the difference between the river and the ocean? In its contents, is there a difference? It's all water. The difference is the form, the embankments, the borders, the shore. Give it a shape, a form, and that you differentiate by saying river and ocean. And now, from this ocean rise the waves, the bubbles, the foam. Now, are these the wave, the bubble, the foam different from the ocean? No, they are also water. So the river was water. Ocean is water, wave is water, bubble is water, foam is water. If you see water, it is there in some form or the other. It's never lost. If you fail to see water like a child, you see the wave, bubble, you see its birth, its death. So the birth and death as appearance of a form never did ever happen any change to the truth, the water. You seeing the wave, you are seeing the bubble, true. You are seeing the river, you are seeing the ocean, true. But they are never in their essence different from water. Failing to see water, carried away by the forms, they are subject to change, including oceans. This is what I learned from Gurudev. India itself is a continent, Africa, African continent, broken, swept off by ocean, flood of waters in the ocean, and hit the sands at the Himalayas. And that is what the Himalayas. And this is India. So even oceans change, rivers change their course, but water doesn't. Similarly, the one truth, the eternal consciousness, the eternal intelligent factor, the eternal existence in its fullness wants to express. So he taps his own creative power, brings out all the names and forms from him, and when he decides to create and identifies with that power, he is called Ishvara. Brahman, the water with a particular name and form, is called Ishvara. And then when he wants to create, he becomes Brahmaji. Same Brahman. And he allows it to be in him, maintains it, he becomes Vishnu. then the creation subsides into him like the wave. He becomes Shiva. Is there anything other than Brahman in this whole process? Ishvara, creator, Brahmaji or Hiranyagarbha, sustainer, Vishnu, destroyer, Shiva. Is there anything other than Brahman? Nothing. He just willed it. They came. When they came out also, they are him only. How did they come? There is a power in him. Because he is all powerful, Sarva Shaktiman. He can do, undo, do otherwise. So he brought out these forms in him. And thus the creator, sustainer, destroyer have come. The created started again multiplying different names and forms. That's you and me. The waves and the bubbles. Are we different from the ocean? Are we different from the creator? Are we different from the water, the Brahman? Not only we are not different, the wave, the bubble, the foam are just appearances, only a form, name, without an independent reality. Similarly, all of us, including Brahmaji, Vishnu, Shiva, are all appearances in that one eternal fact. All right, so what? Still there are differences. He is Sarva Shaktiman, I am Alpa Shaktiman. He is Sarvajna, I am Alpajna. Still there are differences. I am suffering and he is troubling me. So what? He says, the Upanishad says, it's just your imagination that you are different from me. You are in a particular form, not knowing all forms are in you. You are that Brahman, Shiva, Vishnu, Maheshwara, they are all in you. You are not limited by a body. All bodies are in you. That you are different as a body, as an individual, is an imagination. And born out of that imagination, you experience inadequacy, therefore desires, and therefore agitations, therefore fears. See that, really speaking, there is no creation at all. This is the essence of Mandukya, falsification of creation. If creation is falsified, if creation is falsified, there is no mind, because mind is the essence of all the stimuli. It accumulated through its perceptions of objects through the five windows, eyes, ears, nose, etc., etc. You perceive a thing, you see a thing, a thought is born. These accumulated thoughts, flow of thoughts is the mind. No objects, no mind. No mind, where is desire? Where is sorrow? Where is fear? Desire, sorrow, fear, all belong to the mind. Mind sustains by the objects. Objects sustained by the illusion of a creation. No objects, no mind. You are Brahman. Where is fear? Where is desire? So the whole problem, in a split second, in a wink, disappears when you know all my fears, desires, and intuitions were imaginations. Because there is no creation. So the essential teaching in Mandukya is to falsify creation. This is called Ajatavada. Jata, born. Ajata, no birth. Vada, the argument. There is never a creation. I am seeing, you saw several things in the dream. Was there a creation? You saw the wave and the bubble. Who created? Was there a creation? You see the room and the dining hall and the kitchen. Is there a creation? They are just concepts. They are just concepts of space, surrounded by walls, surrounded by forms, imaginations, or concepts of this different forms called the world. There is never a creation. To bring that factor, he brings dream. Oh, dream, okay, but not in the waking. He says both have the same reality. There is no difference from dream and waking. There are a lot of logics. When we come to the text, we will see that. Basically, he says, both are seen. Both are objects. The waking world is seen, objects. The dream world is seen, objects. Objects always change, therefore not real. Waking has the same reality as the dream. They are projections of the mind. They are not different. There are several logics. Oh, in waking I can eat from the fridge. He says in the dream also you can do. Oh, when I'm hungry, dream food won't help. Oh, when you are hungry in the dream, your real food in the fridge won't help. Therefore, there is no difference. So he brings in the dream to show that this world is nothing but a dream. Thus he takes up the world in terms of three states of consciousness: waking, dream, deep sleep. As I said, when Bhagavan wanted to create, he needed a creator, a sustainer, a destroyer. To create, you need rajas. To sustain, you need sattva. And to destroy, you need tamas. So he tapped these potencies in him, together called as maya. And that maya projected all differences. Is there something real as a maya? Nothing. It's his potency, like the wood has fire in it. The fire has heat, light, form. Heat, light, form are not different from the fire. Where from they come? They come from the fire. Where from the fire has come? From the wood. Where were the potencies? Inherent potencies. There are no special things you can identify. Inherent potencies. Similarly, the inherent potencies of the Lord is to throw out something which is really not there, but appears to be there. Asat dhana matram, experienced, but not really there, like the dream. So the whole world is nothing but a projection of sattva, rajas, and tamas. Similarly, this sattva, rajas, tamas, or your waking, sattva, because the intellect can function. Rajas, agitations, intellect cannot function. Dream, tamas, total ignorance, deep sleep. That is our world made of the three gunas, sattva, rajas, and tamas. Right? Now these three gunas stay in what? Brahman. These three gunas stay in your consciousness. Your consciousness supports the waking, supports the dream, supports the deep sleep. The waking is experienced because of the presence of consciousness. Dead body cannot experience. The mind experiences in dream because of the consciousness. In sleep, though the mind and the intellect not functioning, not conscious of the body, you still survive because of the consciousness. Not merely that, you are able to coordinate between your waking, dream, and deep sleep and remember all the three. Therefore, the waking ego is different from dream. In waking, you were a beggar. In dream, you were a king. Both are different. But you remember both. Because you were there, you experienced both. If you are not there, you didn't experience both. You cannot remember. But you are neither the beggar nor the king. The beggar and the king paraded before you, the consciousness. You were unaffected by the beggarliness or the kingliness. That is you. Mere waking, if you say, you will, it's difficult to show this consciousness. When you bring in all the three states, you can show this consciousness to be the one who is consistently there, coordinating these three, and to remember all the three, waking, dream, and deep sleep. So this consciousness supports the waking, supports the dream, supports the deep sleep, not affected by the waking, not affected by the dream, not affected by the deep sleep. The waking, the dream, deep sleep themselves with the gunas have become as though different from him. As though different from him because of the gunas. There's no other creation. Okay? So what? Yeah. You were there in the waking, dream, and deep sleep. Therefore, you must be different from them. Therefore, before their creation, you were different. After the end, you were different. None of those words are there in you. Therefore, you don't have the problem of the waking, dream, or deep sleep. That consciousness which supports the waking, dream, deep sleep, that is what you are. That is what is Brahman, who supports Hiranyagarbha, who supports Brahmaji, who supports Vishnu, who supports Shiva. You are that. My child, he says in the Himalayas, this is represented with a name called Om. This state of consciousness of yours, I shall give a name for you, so that it will help you to contemplate. That is Om. That is you. There's nothing beyond it. It's all. What is there? What will be there? What was there? All that was, that is, that will be, is this consciousness, you. Nothing beyond it. Right? And how does womb fit into this? You could have simply said, this logic is enough. I don't need a womb for this. You are saying, I could understand. No, sir. I said it. You seem to have understood, sir. You need some prop to visualize this. Some prop to visualize this. Travel through the props. Find out their origin and end. See the corresponding states in you. See the corresponding states in you. And in that travel, you shall discover this consciousness. Therefore, you need mere waking dream deep sleep. When you say, you may intellectually vaguely grasp, but you need a detailed discussion where you can visualize the waking dream and deep sleep through props. These props are three letters, A, U, Ma. Together, it's called womb. You need A, U, Ma to correlate with your waking dream and deep sleep states and to see the structure of A, U, Ma, their origin, their sustenance, and their ending, and discover that truth is you. Therefore, this is an aid for you. This is a gadget for you. The womb. And we shall discover here the womb is not merely a gadget, a merely a murti, a merely a pratika. It is in fact all. How? We shall see. So here, we talk about waking, dream, and deep sleep. In waking, the senses are functioning, the intellect is functioning. In dream, these senses are not functioning. There are dream sense organs. Intellect is not functioning fully. Mind is functioning. In deep sleep, none are functioning. Only one thing you know, I don't know anything. Only that thought. Therefore, since there is no plurality, there is no duality, there is no mind and intellect, at that stage, there is only one, this ignorance and pure Brahman consciousness. This clearly you cannot identify in waking and dream, but in deep sleep it is in its pure form of consciousness. But how can I know it deep sleep? What is the use? That is what we are going to do through meditation of womb and womb to bring the state of sleep into waking. In sleep, the mind and intellect, the ego, that can recognize this consciousness is not there. It, consciousness is there, but the instrument to recognize is not there. In waking, you tap this instrument, withdraw from all perceptions consciously, from waking, dream, and vasanas, and see what is left through this instrument, you shall discover there's nothing other than it. When you discover there's nothing other than it, there is no mind, because mind can only be there with objects. In consciousness, when you discover there are no objects, there's no mind. The mind without objects is consciousness. So through meditation, you can travel mentally through the waking dream and to a state of nothingness and see that this state of nothingness is with respect to 1, 2, 3, the fourth state, hence called Turiya, that is the consciousness. If you are following me, it's not intellectual. You can feel the presence of that fourth consciousness. Imagine the waking. All your experiences in the waking, your waking world, leave it for a second. Imagine the dream with all details. Leave it for a second. Imagine the state of deep sleep. Pass on from waking to dream to deep sleep. Experience the nothingness. And that nothingness, in that state, is called samadhi. This is the difference between sleep and samadhi. In sleep, the objects are there, you are not aware of them. In samadhi, there are no objects at all. The presence of objects are denied. In sleep, objects are there, even thoughts are there in you. Those thoughts you are not aware. In samadhi, there are neither the world, nor the thoughts, nor the mind and intellect. So, how do you do? Take A as the symbol. A as the symbol. In that, you see all your waking world. Leave it. Go to Wu. See all your dream world. Leave it. Go to M. Imagine the deep sleep. After that, what? After M. Silence. What is silence? Neither A, nor U, nor M. Neither A, nor U, nor M. That is silence. In that silence, when you consciously practice, even if it is a split second, there are no thoughts. No thoughts, no objects, no mind. That silence itself is consciousness, which is called, with the reference to the 1, 2, 3, the Turiya. This is how the Omkara Upasana is done. A, U, Ma, and silence. Before you started A, what was there? Silence. When you ended A, what was there? Silence. When you began Ma, what was there? Naturally, the same silence should have continued. When you end, it is same silence. Before A, after M, same silence. So in between, silence alone should have been there, appearing to be sounds of Uma. Essence of the sounds of Uma is the silence. Before was silence. Silence was supporting the sound. Supposing there is no silence, can you hear any sound? It will be one jarring. You can't hear sounds. Sounds you can hear because of silence supporting. So silence before, silence in and through, silence later, silence appearing as sounds. Travel through A, waking. Through Wu, dream. Through M, deep sleep. End in silence. Recognize that silence to be the Turiya, the fourth, and you. This is called Omkara Upasana. Even in a simpler way, when you say two ohms, Om, 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 between two ohms there is silence. So therefore, this silence is all through the contents of sounds, supporting the sounds, originating the sounds, dissolving the sounds. Recognize the silence, and that is a state of no mind. Amani Bhava, he says in Mandukya, Amani Bhava, there is no mind. Where there is no mind, you are the consciousness. Very simple. That is why our Paramaguru says, Mandukya's path is a straight path, like an arrow flying. It's not a serpentine route. Same thing is echoed by our Gurudev. So Mandukya, I have justified in starting in the beginning, because Paramaguru and Guru says this is direct, simple, effective text. It's not complicated. If you were available to me, at least some of you in this few minutes would have got at least a glimpse. If you are available to me. Where else can you get these? Therefore, that's the strength of Mandukya. Simple, straight. And hence, I'm justified in starting in the beginning. Some of you may not know, I took the permission of Acharyas. Mitranandji asked him, sometimes on Mondays you have your classes. See, my class starts at 7, yours ends at 7. What do I do? Mitranandji said, go ahead with your class. Then I had to do it in the night. I wrote to Guruji, Mandukya I'm supposed to do in night. He said, don't worry. These days people are more alert in the night than days to do it. You understand? Therefore, I have the blessings of all masters. And hence I can tell you, Mandukya, I have got permission. And that is a simple, direct text. This Mandukya Upanishad has only 12 mantras. Only 12 mantras. Rest is called Karika. By Gaudapada, who is Paramaguru for Sri Shankaracharya. Govindapada is Guru for Sri Shankaracharya. Gaudapada is Guru for Govindapada, hence Paramaguru for Sri Shankaracharya. He has written a Karika. There are mainly three things: Bhashya, Karika, Vartika. Bhashya, commentary. In a commentary, you only have to explain that word precisely. You cannot go on spinning. You just precisely only that word. In Vartika, it's an intelligent analysis of pros and cons. In Kartika, Karika, it's called a glossary, Prakarana Grantha. You only take one aspect of the whole teaching, highlight that teaching, and then give various practices through which you can experience that teaching. That is Karika. Karika is so beautiful, it gains the same status as the Upanishad. Hence, nobody says Mandukya. Everybody says Mandukya Karika. The first chapter, as I said, is only Upanishad 12 mantras with a few Karikas. Agama Prakarana, that is the Upanishad. Agama is Vedas, the main Upanishad. Agama Prakarana. There, the Siddhanta, what is talking, is being given. In that, what is the essence? There is no creation. So it has to be falsified. So you have to be told that the creation that you see is only a delusion and an illusion. So the next chapter is called Vaitakya Prakarana, talking about the illusion of the world. Oh, that's negative. Yes, therefore the third chapter is Advaita Prakarana. The truth behind this illusion is the Advaita. Advaita Prakarana. The fourth is through our various experiences, through an example, Alata Shanti. We'll see that center stick. And in that fourth listing, the various theories of creation by Sankhyas, Vaisheshikas, Nyaya Vaisheshikas, Mimamsakas, Buddhists, Chanika Vijnanavadis, all of them have been taken to discuss this Ajatavada, and Gaudapada tears them into pieces and throws them into Ganges. That is the fourth chapter. So we have four chapters here, talking of the four states of consciousness: the waking, dream, deep sleep, Jagrat, Swapna, Sushupti, and Turiya, the fourth. I am experiencing the blessings of Gurudev when I am talking. And therefore, it should have an effect on you, because I am feeling their presence and their hand on me. Right. And so we now start the text. Hari Om. These two are prayers. Hari Om. Om iti etat aksharam idam sarvam. This word Om syllable is sarvam, everything. The student may think it's everything. Where is there in Uttarakashi before him? No, he says bhutam bhavat bhavishyati. What was there, what is there, what will be there? That is this womb. Tasya upakhyanam, a treatise, a clear exposition, discussion we shall do. Sarvam omkarameva, nothing of the past, present and future other than this omkara. Oh, so it's bound by time, past, present, and future. No, yacha anyat trikala atitam, that which is beyond the time, trikala, that is also omkarameva. That which is beyond the past, present, and future is this omkara. Past, present, and future, or with reference to the experiences. Experiences are reference to the objects. Objects are created. Therefore, that which is beyond the experiences, the objects, the creation, that which remains there is the very origin and the substratum. That is omkara. Right? And then he says, next mantra, wherein comes the Mahavakya. There are four Mahavakyas. One, Aitriya Upanishad from Rigveda, Prajnanam Brahma. Consciousness is Brahman. Then the second one from Mandukya, Ayamatma Brahma. The core of all this is that Brahma, that Atma. The third is that core is you, Tattvamasi, Chandogya. Mandukya from Atharvana Veda, Chandigya from Sama Veda. The student contemplates and experiences and says, yes, Aham Brahmasmi, I am that Brahman. Yajurveda, Brudharanya Upanishad. So here comes the Mahavakya. What is a Mahavakya? Lodarodai is not a sentence. A sentence should convey some meaning. Vakya. A vakya should convey a meaning. What is Mahavakya? That which conveys the highest meaning. What is the highest meaning? Deathlessness, immortality, freedom from limitations. What you may call it as a moksha. How? By saying you are what you are seeking, you are that. By trying to make you see you are that what you are seeking. That which reveals the identity between the seeker and the sought, between the jiva and Brahman, is called a Mahavakya. So Mahavakya here is Ayam Atma Brahma, Sarvam Yetad Brahma. Everything is Brahma. Brahma, the word Brahma means Bhrutva, the biggest. Nothing beyond it. Nothing beyond it. Big itself becomes a noun.
sometimes. How big? Elephant big. So elephant becomes the adjective. Big becomes the noun. Rat big. So big itself is qualified. That which is unqualified, unconditional bigness is called Brahma. Also, Brahma means most glorious. Also, Brahma means that which supports everything. I am Atma Brahma. This core, this essence in all. When names and forms are dissolved, what remains there is this eternal, pure, conscious existence, bliss. That core, that water supported the ocean, the wave, the bubble, this that consciousness supported the waker, the dream, the deep sleeper. That consciousness supported Auma. That essence, which is the essence in you, which is the essence in your imaginary God, Brahman, through a concept of a name and a form, that essence, the water, which is neither the ocean nor the wave, that which is common, remove the name and the form, the ocean and the wave and the bubble, what remains is water. Remove the name and form, so and so, remove the name and form, God. What remains is that Satchidananda. I am Atma Brahma. Soyam Atma Chetushpa. This Atma has four quarters. This Atma has four quarters. Just now you said Atma is infinite. Infinite means that alone is there. Nothing other than that. There is no time, there is no space where it is not there. Now you are saying it has four quarters. That means it's limited. It has parts. No, sir. These quarters are different. These quarters are different. Somebody gives you a 25 paisa coin, which is called quarter rupee. Then he adds another 25 paisa coin. Now, two 25 paisa coin, half a rupee. Another 25 paisa coin, three 25 paisa coins, distinct. But when the fourth is added, you don't say four quarters, you say 1 rupee. You say 1 rupee. The three quarters merged into the fourth one. Similarly, the waking, dream, deep sleep, three quarters, three padas merge into the fourth. They are not distinct there. There is no distinction there. They are not separate from that. The Auma. So it has Chatushpad, four padas. He has said that. Now you have to meditate on each of these padas. What? The first pada, second pada, third pada, the waking, dream, and deep sleep, and discover that the fourth pada, though the essence of the first three, though the support of the first three, is unattached by them, unaffected by them, is completely different from them. Anything that you know, anything that you can think, that is the fourth, the Turiya. So to go there, you have to completely, thoroughly analyze your waking, and through that, you see the consciousness supporting it. You are experiencing the waking because of the consciousness. Go to analyze the dream. See that the consciousness travels through the state of waking to dream and supports the dream and the essence of the dream. Then go to deep sleep and then see that. And then see what is there after that is this consciousness. This is the process of meditation which he starts here. He says, the waking state, jagarti sthane bahish prajnaha saptangaha yekona vinchati mukaha sthula huk vaishwanaraha prathama padaha. The first pada is waking, jagrati sthanaha. The field is waking. Bhishpragnaha, in this state, he is conscious of the external world. Saptangaha, he has seven limbs. Yekona vinchati mukaha, he has 19 mouths. Sthula bhuk, he enjoys gross objects. He is called Vaishvanaraha, Tadamapadaha. Right? We will see these states and beyond this, through the grace, blessings of Guru Parampara, who has been with us, who has been supplying us with various thoughts, who has talked to us now, to that Guru Parampara, the ocean of compassion, we bow down. Om Purnamadaha Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavasishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Hari Om Sri Gurubhyo Namaha. Hari Om. See, there are various